Welcome to the Relationship Enrichment Center, Big Two Coons. Those who are watching us via the videos and on the internet, we welcome you to our Sabbath service here in Tampa, Florida. If you're ever in town, we'd love to have you come.
Amen.
We'd love for you to come to our, also look at our website, www.recministries.org. And also, if you ever do a Google search, we are now our, we have another form of search that you could actually find our church, and that is through Super Media. In other words, how many of you have used the Yellow Pages? This is the internet Yellow Pages. If you do a Google search for marriage, counseling, Hebrew roots of your faith, even my name, they have a not only our original website comes up, but they have a website set up that has all the information about our ministry. So it's a wonderful search site, so we encourage you to look at that. But we are happy to be in the house of the Lord on Sabbath. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And we welcome you all. So let's get into the Word of God tonight. I want you to go to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Understand that people are asking the question, Pastor, we talked about the signs that are coming against America. And America, you know, just like Israel, remember, they have actually considered America a second Israel.
Amen.
America was Israel was blessed. It's a blessed nation, right?
Right.
Right.
God bless Israel. But again, if you look at Isaiah 9:10, God had to wake them up, and he sent the enemy to wake them up and destroy their land.
Right.
And the response to that is the same response that we did after 9/11. And that's why the nine signs have been prophesied and have been fulfilled on U.S. soil. So, again, America is a blessed nation, but because we have turned our back on God. And how many of you know, come on, how many of you would agree with me that this country has turned their back on God?
Amen. Yes.
Come on. Come on. We have turned our backs on God. And because of that, and you don't turn your back on God, see, and what happens is we sometimes are seeking the almighty dollar.
Amen.
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 And when we seek the almighty dollar, remember when the World Trade Center was attacked, you know, and I take that personally. Again, everybody knows I take that personally, because again, it's my country that was attacked. Amen. But also, amen. I lost a relative in that printout.
Mm-hmm.
I lost he was vice president of Fuji Bank, Manny Gomez. And if you do a Google search, you'll find stories about him. And he died at a young age, 42 years old. Just barely married. Still didn't have any children yet. You know, he had his whole life ahead of him. Vice president of Fuji Bank, had his wonderful career, and again, a very intelligent young man. And again, so I take that personally, but again, I take personal what's going on in America.
Yes.
I take personal when abortion is at an all-time high.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Same-sex marriage, we still can't figure out what marriage is all about.
Yes, Lord.
That's a shame.
Yes, it is.
And so we need to get back on track. Amen?
Amen.
So, you know, and again, there's planting that's going on in this country that is not good seed.
Yep.
And I'm just going to read something to you, that every planting that our Heavenly Father has not planted shall be rooted, uprooted.
Amen.
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 And let's look at Second Timothy, I should say. Second Timothy chapter 3. And let's read something tonight. Because again, you know, people say, well, there's other nations besides us that do worse. Well, Israel, you know, was did some great, some bad things too. But understand, God singled out Israel.
Amen.
Blessed them beyond other nations.
That's right.
And when much is given, much is required.
Amen.
Right? So because of that, you know, Israel was judged and is still being judged today.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And we are being judged more than ever because we became the second Israel.
That's right. Yes.
And we are a blessed nation. How many of you know? Look, I've been all over the world. There is nothing like USA.
Yes.
Amen. Trust me. Second Timothy, let's go to Second Timothy. Second Timothy, chapter 3. Verse 1. You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days, there will be very difficult times. For people will love only themselves and their money. Hello.
Amen.
They got to say, you cannot serve the almighty dollar. Because when you serve the almighty dollar and you go after him, the almighty comes after you. So, it says that they will be boastful and proud. Come on.
Amen.
That's a 9-11. I didn't hear too much about God. I heard about that. We're going to build it stronger, better, and bigger and better. Boastful and proud, scoffing at God. Disobedient to their parent, children. And ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred.
Amen.
They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-pity. No self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good.
Amen.
Is that happening?
Amen.
Huh? They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride.
Yes.
Love pleasure rather than God.
Amen.
They will act religious. But they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that. Verse 6. They are the kind who work their way into people's homes and win the confidence of vulnerable women who are burdened with guilt of sin and are controlled by various desires. Such women are forever following new teachings, but they are never able to understand the truth.
Amen.
That's why you gotta be careful who you follow, who you listen to, where you go, and what you watch on TV. I don't care if they say Jesus or not.
Amen.
These teachers oppose the truth, just as Janus, and Jabez opposed Moses. They have deprived minds and a counterfeit faith.
Yep.
But they won't get away with this for long. Some days, everyone will recognize what fools they are. Just as with Janus and Jabez. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Listen. Whatever I say this with me, whatever could be shaken,
shall be shaken.
Okay? Now, everybody say this with me. You are in the end time.
You are in the end time.
All right? Now say this with me. I want you to say this. I am an end time believer.
I am an end time believer.
All right. What does that mean? I'm an end time believer. Well, if you're an end time believer, you got to start doing some good things. And if you've done things in the past that maybe didn't work, you got to start doing it right starting now. Understand something. All of us must stand strong.
Amen.
And the way to stand strong is not to be rooted in the world.
Right.
Cannot be rooted in the world. Cannot be rooted in religion.
That's right.
To stand strong. Amen. Religion has no part of God.
Amen.
God came to establish a kingdom, not a religion.
That's right.
Amen.
You need to be rooted in Yeshua Messiah. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, you need to be rooted in your Hebrew roots.
Come on. Amen.
And you are not to put your trust in security or well-being.
Amen.
Or any joy in this world.
Amen.
We have too many people who are too attached to the world.
Yes.
And are dependent on the world.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. And that's not what God is all about.
Amen.
Write this down, please. Dependencies will kill you. Dependencies will kill you.
Yes.
What are you dependent on?
Come on.
Now, the only dependent See, that will not kill you is God.
Amen.
Yes. Any other dependencies will kill you.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
Amen.
Lisa, am I right?
Amen.
I had a dependency on drugs.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Lisa did. Don't look at me so spiritual, but some of you had dependency on food.
No.
Amen.
Yes.
Most of our children, you know, most of our children, I say a joke sometimes, my children were attached to a life support system at home, the refrigerator. Amen. But look, listen to me, we could be dependent on certain things.
Right.
Right.
Amen. And we have to learn to take control.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
And I'm talking for me, I need to take control of more things in my life. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Dependency will kill you. The only thing, again, that will not kill you is dependency on God. Because if you are, again, caught up in the world more than God, you will lose always.
Yes.
Amen.
You will always
amen.
Lose.
Amen.
You will never win. Don't stop affecting the world, but separate what is binding you. We have to become light and not darkness.
Amen.
But it could only happen if you become rooted in God and rooted in your Hebrew roots of your Christian faith. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right. Now let's get into this tonight. I want you to write a sabbatical year. We're going to talk about the Sabbath. We're going to talk about God's ordained day, but also what is sabbatical. We're going to talk about a mystery of the sabbatical year that is written anciently in the Bible that actually has affected America and is affecting you. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Now, I want you to write this word down and I'm going to spell it for you. It's called Shemitah. Shemitah, she, like she, me, ta, okay? Shemitah. Now what is this? How many of you have not heard of this? Raise your hand. Good. Go to Leviticus 25. Leviticus 25, starting in the first verse. We're going to talk about the mystery of the sabbatical year. God, how many of you know that God has set certain things in motion from the very beginning?
Amen.
Even in Genesis, he says, I created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, and the seventh I rested. Right?
Yeah.
Everybody say seven.
Seven. Yeah.
Okay. Now the Shemitah. This is the Hebrew word for actually sabbatical year. Also known as the year of faith. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Leviticus 25, verse 1. While Moses was on Mount Sinai, the Lord said to him, give the following instructions to the people of Israel. When you have entered the land, I am giving you, the land itself must observe a Sabbath rest before the Lord every seventh year. Everybody say every seventh year.
Every seventh year.
Okay. For 6 days you may plant your fields. Is that by accident in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and seventh he rested?
No.
Huh?
No.
And can I tell you something? Any other day that you worship God, fine, you can worship God 7 days a week, but it's one day that God commands you to worship him, and that is the Sabbath.
Amen.
Amen.
And without worshiping the Sabbath, you will never really have eternal rest.
Amen.
You know?
Amen.
Take away, now listen to me. There's people I'd rather work on the Sabbath to pay my bills, to get out of debt, but they're not here.
Amen.
Nothing was wrong with that picture.
Amen.
So they're serving Almighty Dollar, not Almighty God.
Amen.
There's no excuse.
Yes.
You got to make time for God.
Amen.
You have to make time for God. Because again, God at the end, right now, we're at, I believe, trust me, we're at the end.
Yes, Lord.
This is judgment time.
Yes.
Amen.
God is going to judge more and more, and you can't wait till the last minute to try to make it in.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
This is a time to change. Amen? And we heard a lot about change in the last election. And the word change, in Hebrew, is the word return. And instead of returning back to God, we changed away from God.
That's right.
Amen.
Come on now.
Come on.
Amen.
Everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right? Now, so let's look at this again. Let's go back to Leviticus. Let's look at this. Now, so it says in verse 3, for 6 years you may plant your field and prune your vineyards and harvest your crops, but during the seventh year, the land must have a Sabbath year of complete rest. It is the Lord's Sabbath. Do not plant your field or prune your vineyards during that year, and don't store away the crops that grow on their own or gather the grapes for your, come on,
amen,
for your unpruned vines. The land must have a year of complete rest.
Yeah.
But you may eat, come on, but you may eat whatever the land produces on its own during the Sabbath. In other words, okay, if something grows, okay, fine, that's good. But you don't go and make it happen.
Right, amen.
We got people trying to make it happen.
Come on,
man. I'm going to get out of debt.
Come on.
So I don't go to church on Sabbath.
Yeah.
And guess what? You're going to lose it at the end.
Amen.
Amen.
Because that's, I'm going to show you, that has already happened to America. And it will happen to you and anyone you know that is following that path.
Amen.
Now, it says in verse 5, and don't store, okay, I'm sorry, let's go on a little bit more. Verse 7, in other words, it says, I'll back up a little bit, verse 6, you may eat whatever the land produces on his own during the Sabbath. This applies to you, your male and female servants, your hired workers. Come on. What is it? What applies to anyone in your household?
Yes.
Yes, Lord.
If they're under your roof and they're not here tonight, you're accountable.
Amen.
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 You're accountable. Amen. That's why anybody stays in my house. So me and my husband should serve the Lord. I don't care if you're visiting, a neighbor. I don't care if you're a relative. I don't care. I go to church, you go to church.
Amen.
Oh, I got family coming in. Oh, guess what? My family's coming in from out of town. They come to church too.
Amen.
Because I'm not going to play with this. Because I have to answer to God.
Amen.
Amen. So the only reason nobody's staying in your house is they're not honoring the Sabbath. Because if you're going to be judged for that.
Hello.
Amen. I'm not saying that God is. I'm just telling you what God says. Alright? Right. This applies, what God says, read it again. This applies to you, your male and female servants, your hired workers, and the temporary, if it applies to either people that work for you.
Come on. Amen.
Alright? Who live with you. Does it say that?
Amen.
Verse 7, your livestock and the wild animals in your land, you will also be allowed to eat what the land produces. All right. So everybody say Shemitah.
Shemitah.
Now Shemitah, again, let me explain what that word means. It also means release. In other words, Shemitah is also an awesome way how God balances things. He balances nature. He balances the world. And Shemitah basically is also a time, we have heard it as a year of Jubilee. And all of a sudden, all I've got to pay. Every outstanding debt is done. You can't go after it. It's done.
Amen.
Now, let's go to Deuteronomy 15. I'm going to show you, this is very important to God. Deuteronomy 15, verse 1. It says, at the end of every seventh, watch this, at the end of every seventh year, you must cancel the debt of everyone who owes you money. I'm still waiting for that phone call.
Amen.
Pastor, church is paid off. Praise God. But there's a reason why things like this are not happening. This country is not doing it.
Right.
All right. We're in more debt now than ever.
Amen.
Now go to 2 Chronicles 36. Let me show you something. 2 Chronicles. Before I read the verse, let me set it up for you. 2 Chronicles chapter 36. All right, now watch this. It says, what this message is about is that I'm going to teach you things that even most economists or even Nobel Prize winners may not even know. But I thank God that you are believers in God, and you, and some of you, let me tell you something, there's things. The specialists out there that claim to be economists, and these economists can't figure out what's going on.
Right.
Amen? Now, we are going to teach what is happening in America, what has happened in America, and what may happen to America if we don't turn it around. We're going to look at Wall Street. We showed last week Wall Street. Remember we talked about Wall Street? And what is one of the symbols in Wall Street? The bull. What was the symbol of when Moses was on the mountain?
That bull.
Nah, the golden calf, same thing. All of a sudden, World Trade Center gets hit. Wall Street is right there.
Right. Amen.
There's a golden calf. Judgment comes. We turn our back on God. We turn our back on God more and more.
Yeah.
Now, so through Wall Street and through Capitol Hill, because of what they have done, is affecting each and every one of you tonight. Amen. Now, it's a mystery. One of the prophets that I love is Prophet Jeremiah.
Amen.
And 2 Chronicles, believe it or not, the reason they call it Chronicles is because God is allowing, again, these Chronicles to show us from the past what could happen. Israel was favored by God, was created by God,
yes.
Was chosen by God,
yes.
Was blessed by God.
Amen.
And judgment starts in the house of the Lord.
That's right.
Amen. God is not a respecter of person.
Right.
I don't care if you're Jewish or not.
Right.
If you mess it up, I'm gonna burn you.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Hello. Amen. Now, understand that when you read Chronicles, I love Chronicles because again, there's a lot of information in Chronicles in First and Second. But if you read this, what is the purpose of Chronicles? Is this basically is to unify God's people, to trace the Davidic line, and to teach the genuine worship that ought to be the center of every individual. Now, If you understand, the author of Chronicles is Ezra. Ezra is why we even read the Torah portions.
Amen.
That's right.
Okay? Now what happens is, they went into exile. They went into captivity. Judah went into captivity. Why did they go into captivity? Because they rebelled against God. Disobedient. Why did Israel get attacked in 9? Come on, Isaiah 9:10. Why did they get attacked by the Assyrians? Because they turned their back on God. Amen. Why did we get hit at 9/11? Was it just a terrorist attack? No, we turned our back on God.
Amen.
And the World Trade Center was a symbol of money.
Yes.
Mammon.
Yes.
Okay?
Amen.
But the prophet Jeremiah, I'm going to show you some other scriptures about him, records, and he's wandering through the ruins of Jerusalem. He's seeing what the devastation that is going on because of the trial and the tribulations that happen because of their disobedience. But he notices a city that is gone. And everything stopped. All the work stopped. The marketplace was silent. Everything. Everything was in ruins. And this was the end of Judah. Almost. Thank God for God's mercy.
Amen.
But it was a day of reckoning. It had come for the kingdom of Judah. And they have passed the point. Listen to me. The reason God allowed this to happen is because they passed the point of no return. God sometimes has to allow devastation to get our attention.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. The Lord had pleaded with the nation, turn back.
Yeah.
But they didn't. Let's read. 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse 15. The Lord, the God of their ancestors, repeatedly sent his prophets to warn them, for he had compassion on his people and his temple. But the people mocked their messengers of God and despised their word. They scoffed at the prophets until the Lord's anger could no longer be restrained and nothing could be done. So the Lord brought the king of Babylon. You think Babylon is dead? Still alive.
Amen.
Brought the king of Babylon against them. The Babylonians killed Judah's young men, even chasing after them into the temple. They didn't care. They went into the synagogue and killed them.
That's right.
Killing both young men and women, the old and the infant. But God handed all of them over to who?
Nebuchadnezzar.
King Nebuchadnezzar. And remember, you know, he came close. This king came closest to anyone to destroy all of Israel.
Yes.
Right.
And guess who? Guess whose idol he was? Saddam Hussein. His most famous idol was King Nebuchadnezzar.
Yes.
Saddam Hussein. Ahmadinejad, I call him the mad jihad.
Mm-hmm.
All of these people want to follow in King Nebuchadnezzar's footsteps. They want to destroy Israel,
destroy
America.
Yeah.
Amen? And they're going to give him an opportunity. And see, here's the thing. If we don't turn our back on God, God takes his hands off and he'll allow it.
Yeah.
Right.
That's right.
Somebody assigned. Because of 9/11, we've been devastated, and we still are not recovered yet.
That's right.
Come on.
Amen.
We're in the longest war ever in the Middle East.
Right?
Yeah.
All right? Now, let's skip down to verse 21. Actually, verse 17 of 2 Chronicles 36. I'm sorry, verse 21. Let's skip there. So the message of the Lord spoken to Jeremiah was fulfilled, and the land finally enjoyed the Sabbath rest. Lying, how did it rest finally? desolate. Desolate. God had to allow the enemy to kill it.
Yeah.
You don't want to stop? You'd rather work on the Sabbath? Or am I going to stop you on the Sabbath?
Amen. Amen.
Hello? You want to work? Go ahead. You want to dishonor the Sabbath? Go ahead. Alright? So we either do it God's way, or we're going to see the highway, and there may be no highway to run.
Amen.
Because it's desolate. So God says, you know what? I'm going to make it rest one way or the other. So he destroyed everything. Now, if you got everything destroyed, that's nothing you can do. Everything is ruined.
Right.
You got to rest. You got to put your hand in your pocket and say, oh, well. Now, even though God allowed the enemy to destroy Judah, God was not finished with Judah. Again, he extended his mercy. God will again eventually end their captivity, you know the story, and bring them back from Babylon, back to their land, and cause them to rebuild their land. The captivity was a correction of judgment, and it will not end until, listen to me, you may want to write this down, God's judgment will never end until God's purpose is fulfilled.
Amen.
Now, let's go to Jeremiah 29:10. Because God gave Jeremiah a good answer. Jeremiah 29:10. This is what the Lord says. You will be in Babylon for what? 70 years. But then I will come and do it for you and all good things I have promised. And I will bring you home again. For I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. They are not plans. They are plans for good and not for disaster. One of my favorite scriptures.
Amen.
To give you a future and a hope. See, many of us read this and we don't know why. Oh, well. The plans he had for. But why did he say that to Judah? Because he said, you know what? I'm giving you another chance to do it right. God has given us plenty of chances to do it right. It's not happening.
Yeah.
Got election coming up. A chance to do it right. So think about this. They were in captivity for how many years? 70. What does the number 70 mean? Maturity. Why? Remember God told Moses to pick elders at 70 years old. Sign of maturity. But Peter went to the Lord and said, Lord, why can I, how many times do I forgive them? Because Peter wanted to kill somebody. Like some of you do. I think when you get mad at someone. Remember Peter had foot and mouth disease. Peter had a bad temper. He had a prophetic business. He had a prophetic lifestyle. He wanted to really, you know, he told it like it is.
That's right.
He had foot and mouth disease. So he's asking Christ, he's trying to figure out a way not to forgive somebody and just probably, you know, leave it for that. And he said, okay, I need to forgive you. And how many times do I forgive, Lord? He said 70 times 7. And people say, well, 490 times? But that also has a significance because think about it. When they were in captivity, I'm going to show you this, the Shemitah, when they were in captivity, they were in captivity for 70 years, but actually, remember, they went into captivity again for 490 years. Now, I'll just say something. The God is showing us through this 70 times 7, the 7 is the number of perfection, 7 is the number of maturity. So when you forgive, you got to forgive until you become mature and then become perfected.
Amen.
And then become perfected and you become mature.
Amen.
So that's what God is saying by 70 times 7. Now, let's go to 2 Chronicles again, chapter 36, just to make a point, and verse 21. So Jeremiah 29:11 is very, I love that scripture, but understand that we have to understand why he said that. 2 Chronicles 36:21, let's read it again. So that nothing that the Lord has spoken through Jeremiah was fulfilled, the land finally enjoyed the Sabbath rest, lying desolate until the 70 years were fulfilled, just as the prophet had said. The prophet came to warn. We are crying out. I'm crying out. I'm hoping people are watching and listening. America, wake up.
Amen.
The captivity lasted 70 years. The Sabbath rest. Now, let me show you something about Sabbath. Keeping your finger there. Why is Sabbath so important to God? Everybody say why,
Pastor.
Why?
Because that is God's ordained day. See, that is God's ordained method. And God instituted it from the beginning.
Amen.
Right?
Yes.
Now, I want you to go through the book of Ezekiel. The question I'm asking you is, how many of you, think about it, how many of you, you remember the parable of the lost coin? In Luke 15, remember when we taught all that?
Yes.
The parable? There were 10 coins. The one was missing.
Yes.
Remember the woman was searching for the lost coin?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right? The question is, how many of you once were missing the lost coin?
Amen.
Amen. Come on now.
You're here tonight, so you're not missing it now. But many of you were worshiping on Sunday, missing the lost coin.
That's right. Yeah.
That's right. Amen. That's right.
Because 10 was the number of the 10 commandments. And 9 commandments don't make 10.
That's right.
59 minutes will make an hour.
Amen.
10 is 10. And the 4th commandment, the majority of the church don't serve.
Right.
That's right.
The 4th commandment.
That's right.
Coin is missing.
Yes.
There's a sign, isn't it?
Yes.
Take the sign.
Take
the Sabbath.
It's
a sign.
It's a sign.
Huh? All right?
Come on, man.
Now, the Bible also says in Revelation that at the end you have a choice to take the mark or follow the sign.
Amen.
The sign is Sabbath.
Come on.
Anything else is a mark.
Amen. Come on.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Come on,
somebody.
Oh, how about taking the sign of the beast? Keep on worshiping on Sunday, you are.
Yeah.
Oh, that's really holy ground.
That's right.
Come on.
Come on now.
You want me to tell you the truth, or you want me to just pacify you and say it's okay?
Amen.
Just like you're supposed to be told.
Come on, man.
The Sabbath is a sign.
Yes.
Amen.
Come on, man.
Sunday's never been Sabbath.
Amen. That's right.
It's a mark.
Yes,
Lord. It's a mark that it came from Babylon. The book of Revelation says Babylon had fallen. Who's going to stand but on the Sabbath?
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Why? Because you're a sign.
Right.
And God protects a sign.
Amen.
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 Your choice. We figure it out. Ezekiel 20. Ezekiel 20. Verse 33. As surely as I live, says the sovereign Lord, I will rule over you with an iron fist in great anger, and with awesome power. And in anger, I will reach out with my strong hand and powerful arm, and I will bring you back. Say thank you, Lord, for bringing me back.
Thank you, Lord, for bringing me back.
Because remember, we were missing the lost coin
at
one time. And now he brought us back.
Yes.
Amen. And there are people today that are still telling you that you need to go back. You got relatives that are telling you you're wrong.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Yes.
That they're right.
Yes.
They're in the right day. You're in the wrong day. All you got to do is ask, prove that to me biblically. They can't do it. And it says, and I will bring you back from the land that you were scattered. We were scattered.
Yeah.
Where are we? Come on. Verse 36, I will bring you into the wilderness of the nation, and there I will judge you face to face. I will judge you there just as I did your ancestors in the wilderness after bringing them out of Egypt, says the sovereign Lord. I will examine you carefully and hold you to the terms of a covenant. I will purge you of all those who rebel and revolted against you. I will bring them out, come on, of the countries where they are in exile, but they will never enter the land of Israel. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God. Verse 39. As for you, O people of Israel, say, I'm Israel. He's talking to you now. See, he's talking to me. This is what the sovereign Lord says. Go right ahead and worship your idols.
Come on now.
Amen.
Yes.
Hello?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm a Christian. I love the Lord. Break out those Christmas trees. We're getting into that time. You want me to tell you the truth?
Amen.
It's not right. Jeremiah, the prophet Jeremiah. Where is that scripture found where it says, do not put trees like the pagan nations do? Jeremiah 10.
Yeah.
It says it right there. Just do not cut down trees and bring them into your house.
Yeah, that's
right.
Oh.
Hello?
Amen.
You could do whatever you want. Bring five of them in. Go ahead. That's up to you. You don't answer to me, you answer to him.
Right.
Now that you know the truth, you can't say you didn't know. Can't say you didn't know. It's too late. You already heard it.
Amen.
Those who are watching, too late. Amen. Now watch this now. He says, go ahead. Worship your idols. But sooner or later you will obey me and will stop bringing shame on my holy name.
Hallelujah.
By worshiping idols.
Yeah.
Verse 40. For my holy mountain, the great mountain of Israel, says, the sovereign Lord, the people of Israel, will someday worship me and I will accept them. There I will require that you bring me all your offering and choice gifts and sacrifices. Verse 41. When I bring you home from exile, you will be like a pleasing sacrifice to me. And I will display my holiness through you as all the nations watch. Everybody's going to say, well, wait a minute, man. They're going to be watching you underneath their Christmas tree, and they're going to be, you'll be blessed. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Go ahead. Worship. Go ahead. Keep those tistles then going. Amen. Then, verse 42. Then when I have brought you home to the land I promised with a solemn oath to give to your ancestors, you will know that I am the Lord. Verse 43, you will look back, come on, look back on all the ways you defy yourself, and you and will hate yourself because of the evil you have done. In other words, God's going to show you.
Come on.
You're putting up all kinds of, oh, Lord. Thank God I've been set free.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Verse 44. You will know that I am the Lord, O people of Israel, when I have honored my name by treating you mercifully in spite of your wickedness. I, the Son of the Lord, have spoken. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Now, so God is doing what? God is bringing his scattered sheep out of the nations, right?
Right.
All right? And where is he bringing them to?
Back.
No, he's bringing them to the wilderness.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
Right? Okay, go to Micah. I know some of you have never been there, but let's go to Micah. Not Michael Jackson, Micah. Okay? It's in the Bible. All right? That fact, right after Jonah, you're looking rich. Let's go to Micah chapter 2. Now, who was Micah? People say, well, not a prophet that too many people speak about. Micah was the native of Moresh. It was a place near Gath, about 20 miles southwest of Jerusalem. And God used this man to warn God's people that judgment is coming, and to offer pardon for all, and for them to repent. Now, so the key people he's spoken to is Samaria and Jerusalem. And here in verse 12 of Micah chapter 2, Micah chapter 2, verse 12. Someday, O Israel, I will gather you. I will gather the remnant who are left. Say, thank God I'm the remnant.
Thank God.
I want to look. I do not follow crowds.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, man. That's because everybody, I don't care. You go ahead. I'm not going. Amen? Watch this. I will gather the remnant who are left. I will bring you together again like sheep in a pen, like a flock in the pasture. Come on. You bring it back to the sheepfold, right?
Yeah.
You and your land will again be filled with noisy crowds. Your leader will break out and lead you out of exile, out through the gates of the enemy city, back to your own land. Your king will lead you. The Lord himself will guide you.
Amen.
All right? Now, so let's look at this. The Lord seeks for who? His people.
Yep.
His lost sheep, right?
Yeah.
Right? And he does it on a what? On a what kind of day? A cloudy day. Cloudy and dark day. Why cloudy and dark day? Why? Because we have gone through trials and tribulation.
Yeah.
And maybe we have learned and returned back to God now. And God says, on that day, on that dark and cloudy day, now that you see who I am, are you ready to come back home?
Amen. Amen.
So, God causes them to pass under what? Now, let's look at this. If you go back to Ezekiel 20, go back to Ezekiel 20, so you can see it for yourself. Okay, Ezekiel 20. Alright? Now, you understand verse 33. It says, as I surely, Ezekiel 20, verse 33, as surely as I live, says the Son of the Lord, I will rule over you with what? Iron fist in great anger. Or an iron rod. Right? How many of you have iron rod in your Bible? Anybody have iron rod? You have iron rod? Alright? With awesome power. Okay? Now, so God is doing what? He's causing them to pass under an iron, a strong arm or an iron. You use iron rod. The rod is what? What is the rod in Hebrew? Rod in Hebrew is Torah. Okay? Spoil the rod. I mean, if you spare the rod on a child, you spoil them. If you spare, you're teaching them the Torah.
Come on.
And if they're in your house, you should be teaching them the Torah.
Right.
And the first part of the Torah is honor the Sabbath.
Amen.
All right, then it says, let's go. And he's counting sheep. He's counting them. Right? Yeah. Making sure that everyone that is lost is now found. Then he brings them into what? A bond or a covenant. Right? Now, let's look at the word rod. The word rod, besides Torah, also in Hebrew means shebet. Okay? Strong's, if you like to follow Strong's Concordance 7626, pronounce shevet or shevet, where we get the word Shabbat. Okay? In other words, in Hebrew, if you understand Hebrew, you spell it, it's called Shin Betet. And now notice the Shabbat. And if I change the tet to tav, the end result of rod becomes shabbat, where we get sabbat, shabbos, we sang that song, shabbos?
Yes.
Shabbat, sabbat, shabbat. In other words, when the Lord brings his scattered sheep out of the nation, he'll ask him to pass under the rod or sabbat. And that is his measuring stick for his people.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Are you following me?
Yes.
Is that heavy?
Yes.
Oh, you like that, huh? Look, can I get an offering now? All right, listen to me. I want you to listen to this. In other words, God is bringing back his scattered sheep to his scattered sheep. Out of where? The nations or wilderness, right?
Yes.
Right? Where we were.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So he's asking them to pass under a rod.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The rod is a Sabbath. In other words, okay, I'm going to see who's my sheep. Well, who's the measuring stick? The measuring stick is a Sabbath.
Amen.
So those who are following the Sabbath is his sheep.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Huh?
Hallelujah.
That's the measuring stick.
Hallelujah.
Say Shabbat.
Shabbat.
And why the Shabbat? Because God said it is a sign between you and me.
Amen.
All right? Yeah. Everybody write the word oat. Put oat. Out. 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 Where we get minut or minute. God says, remember, in Matthew 5:17, unto every dot or tittle.
Yeah.
Until every oat.
Yeah.
Until every minute.
Yeah.
Until everything.
Yeah.
Passes under my rod.
Amen.
It's not going to be fulfilled.
Amen.
Everything is fulfilled under his minute. Or minute. His time. His time is perfect. The Sabbath is his time. The Sabbath is his day.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah.
Matthew 17 is very clear. In other words, everything that is lost is going to be found in the last day, but it has to pass down or has to pass under the rod or the measuring stick of the Sabbath.
Amen.
And that's how he knows. Why did he say in the fourth commandment? Read the fourth commandment. God said, I have to keep the Sabbath holy. What? Separate?
Yeah. Yeah.
From all other days.
Mm-hmm.
So people will know that I am your God.
Yeah.
And that you are my people.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Amen. So he's bringing back restoration. So why the sabbatical year? Because that's a sign. When he said, wait, did God just put it in the Bible to hear himself speak? Oh, keep the Sabbath rest. After 7 years, rest the land. Listen to me, rest the land, people of Israel. But you're not listening to me, so you know what? I'm going to make a rest for you.
Right. Amen.
See, the Sabbath rest until the 70 years mere, listen to me. In other words, nothing was fulfilled. The Lord's word was spoken to Jeremiah, but they did not listen to Jeremiah. The key here is what? What is the key? Say that. What is the key? Say the Sabbath. Don't tell me you are a believer. Tell me you're a Sabbath keeper.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Because that's going to be your sign that you are.
Yes.
Thank you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Come on now. Thank you.
And we have so many people, look, good people that are just, they're in churches, but guess what? They're not accountable because they don't know. We were there.
Right.
They're innocent. They really are. They're innocent. They don't know. But it's going to be a rude awakening, man, when God says, okay, wait a minute, I got my people going under my rod. Well, who are you? Yeah. Oh, okay, well, just wait till we pass my people, then you could maybe, I'll let you in. I have to be in that position. I have to be in that position. I want to get in. Listen to me, there's an inner court and an outer court.
That's right.
In other words, listen to me, the Sabbath is like a wedding.
That's right.
It's a wedding. And God is inviting you to the wedding.
Yeah.
The bridal chamber.
Yes.
Amen.
And what are you going to say? I didn't know. It was a wedding? I didn't know. Well, those who are watching know now.
Amen.
Amen.
And you know, it's a Sabbath. So what's the key? What's the key to God's people? The Sabbath. The land had to keep the Sabbath rest. Just like people have to keep the Sabbath rest.
Right. Amen.
Now, what's it all about? You see, in Babylon, the land was, again, dormant, and you couldn't work on the land because it was a Sabbath rest, and God was also causing what is called, write this down, a judgment Sabbath. A judgment Sabbath. Shemitah. Leviticus 25, verse 2. Let's go back there again real quickly. Leviticus 25. How many of you are, nobody has gotten offended yet, right? If you have, then you're in the right place. Because I'm not here to please you.
Come on. Amen.
Now, I know what Jeremiah went through. He was a prophet crying in the wilderness.
Yes, sir.
And people were persecuting him.
Amen.
Leviticus 25, verse 2. While Moses was among, I'm sorry, verse 2. Give the following instructions to the people of Israel. When you have entered the land, I am giving you the land itself. Not only you observe the Sabbath, but the land must observe the Sabbath.
Yes.
Rest before, come on, the Lord, every 7 years. Say every seventh year.
Seventh year.
Now, in other words, it wasn't just that the Sabbath was the seventh day of the week.
Right.
But every 7 year was a Sabbath year rest.
Amen.
But every 7th year was a Sabbath year rest. Everybody, 7th year.
7 years.
Sabbath rest.
Sabbath rest.
Which is in Hebrew is called again what?
Shemitah.
Say Shemitah.
Shemitah.
All right? Now, again, this also means, Shemitah also means letting go. Letting go. The remission, the letting, the rest, and also means rest. Letting go. Release. So every 7th year, God was allowing the land to rest. But again, the requirement for the Shemitah, if you go back to Leviticus 25 and verse 4, what are the requirements? During the 7th year, the land must have a Sabbath rest of complete rest. It is the Lord's Sabbath. Do not plant your fields or prune your vineyard during that year. In other words, leave it alone. Trust me.
Amen.
Sakalamana. Everybody say Sakalamana. Sakalamana means take your hands off, man. Go to Exodus 23. Watch this. I've got about 5-7 minutes left. Exodus 23. Verse 10. Exodus 23, verse 10 and 11. Plant and harvest your crop for 6 years, but let the land be, what? Renewed and lie uncultivated during the seventh year. Then let the poor among you, come on, harvest whatever he grows on his own. In other words, he's supposed to even give it to the poor.
Yeah.
Leave the rest for the wild animals to eat. The same applies to your vineyards and olive groves. In other words, during that year, and everybody planted, so everybody had what they needed, so if they planted, they were smart, they planted. Amen? I'm not saying to hoard, it's not people hoard. I'm not supposed to tell you to hoard. We got hoarders. You ever seen that movie, those documentaries of hoarders? You ever seen that? That's crazy. That's disgusting. That's the spirit of demonic activity.
Yes.
Wow. Amen? How can you live under those environments? Now, so God is saying, in other words, if you own land, you are required to open up your land to everyone.
Yeah.
Come on. Sit. Yeah. This is Shemitah. Yeah. Everybody come, it's free.
That's right.
Amen? And they can partake of it. The poor can partake equally as the rich. So in the seventh year of Shemitah, everything that belongs to anyone becomes the property of everyone. Community sharing. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah.
And then we're required to leave the gates open. Don't close the gates now. Now in the Shemitah, the seventh year, the Israelites were to also apply to letting go of each other's debt. And say, you know what? If you owe me something on that day, on the Shemitah, you don't owe me anything anymore. Isn't that beautiful?
Yes.
So those who owe me after 7 years, I'll forgive you. But you need to pay me now. Because if you know, I know a guy by the name of Guido. And I really do. Can I say something? Even bankruptcy, when you file bankruptcy, normally for 7 years.
Yep.
You can't get credit again. You know that?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, basically, you can, but at a high interest rate. So even the laws were written according to Shemitah.
Yes, Lord.
All right? Now, let's look at this again. Now, you say, well, Pastor, what does this have to do with 9/11 and the prophecies and the judgment of America? Well, let's look at this. Well, first of all, I want you to write this down. The actual Shemitah that is recorded in the Hebrew calendar is called the month of Elul. Or the month of Elul, the Hebrew calendar. Elul. Alright? And now to us, it's between August and September. Okay? Alright?
Amen.
Remember, it's the end of the year. So we get to the new year.
Amen.
So I'm preaching this on Shemitah. Going into the new year. Alright? So it's the 29th of the month of Elul. It was the last day of the civil year. It was the end of every 7 years. The Elul 29 became again the focal point of the Shemitah. It was the final or peak, and this law will apply to everything in the economic realm. It was an economic, what is called equalization. The Shemitah was a year of blessing or jubilee. Now, what does any of this again have to do with 9/11? Well, if you understand, remember when the children of Israel went into captivity in Chronicles, all right, And again, if you want to go back to 2 Chronicles chapter 36, just to kind of keep your finger there a little bit as we're closing, because I know I'm running out of time, and we'll do part two of this next week. We'll be hanging a little bit. 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse 3. 2 Chronicles 36, verse 3. That he was disposed, in other words, remember, Judah went into exile to Babylon, right? In verse 3, then he was disposed by the king of Egypt, who demanded that Judah pay 7,500 pounds of silver and 75 pounds of gold as tribute. Okay? Verse 4, the king of Egypt went and installed Eglon, the brother of Jehoahaz, as the next king of Judah and Jerusalem, and he changed Eglon's name to Jehoiakim. Then Necho took Jehoahaz, man, his name is a prisoner, to Egypt as a prisoner. And Jehoiakim was 25 years old when he became, I haven't named somebody, hey, Jehoiakim, what's up, bro? And he reigned in Jerusalem 11 years. He did what was evil in the right in the sight of the Lord, his God. Then King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon came to Jerusalem and captured it, and he found Jehoiakim in bronze chains and led him away to Babylon. Again, bronze meaning judgment. Okay? Now, in other words, let's...